Hi everyone, my name is Nick, and today we're going to talk about tiny plants. So these are plants that you purchase small at the plant store and they stay small for years, even as they are actively growing. So these are such incredible plants to grow in your space if you have a small space or you don't want your plant to outgrow your windowsill or your desk or whatever you have. You do not need to worry about these plants getting big. And all of these, except for one, are plants that I've been growing in my home for at least a year, if not two, three, or maybe even four in some cases. And they are all as small as can be. They're adorable. You're gonna love this. Okay, so the first one we're gonna talk about today is, let's talk about this one. I think this is a super fun one. And of course I stationed it all the way in the back. So this is a Cryptanthus bivitatis. And this one in particular is called the pink star. So Cryptanthus bivitatis pink star. And they refer to this commonly as earth stars, which is probably why its name is pink star. So this is a terrestrial bromeliad, terrestrial meaning that it grows in soil. Many other bromeliads like acmeas and nerugelias are known for growing in like on a tree setting where you can grow them on a plaque or like in a moss basket. Well, this is something you would probably want to grow in a terracotta pot and just some normal potting mix or some succulent soil. And this is a plant I have had for probably about 2.5, maybe three, not quite three, like about 2.5 years, I would say. And you can see how small it is. It's really just this really lovely clump of plant. It's actually quite enigmatic. I really love it. And the thing about Cryptanthus is the way they grow. That's why they stay so small. So just like other bromeliads, you typically are going to buy your Cryptanthus as just one plant in the pot. So at one point in time, if you go way back in my videos, this was just one of these little stars that you see coming off that have kind of a rosette shape to them. This plant right here is covered in rosettes. And the reason why it's covered in rosettes is because, as I was saying, the way that these plants grow. So you're going to buy them, one plant in the pot, and then the plant's going to bloom. Now, some bromeliads have some really breathtaking blooms. Cryptanthus, on the other hand, you're probably not even going to notice that it bloomed. But after the plant blooms, it's going to put all of its energy into creating all these pups. So technically, the original plant that's in the pot is dying. If you look around the base, I still have all of these leaves sticking out here. Some of them are starting to turn brown and die back. But over time, that mother plant is going to die back completely as all of these pups are taking over. So that's why this plant looks so interesting in this clump, but I am completely obsessed with it. Now, this is a plant that's perfect for a really bright window. I'd say your best bet is growing this in a south or west facing window, as in that intense light, it's where this plant's gonna get all of that color. So you can even see some of the plants that are kind of hidden under the clumps or have more of like a green palish color to them, while the plants on top really do sport that pink color. And there are plenty of other varieties of Cryptanthus bivitatis. I know there's the red star, which looks basically exactly like this, but with some really heavy red foliage. There's the black mystic, or there's a bunch of different varieties that have like black and white foliage. They're all fantastic. You're gonna find Cryptanthus of practically any color out there. But if you wanna hold on to that color, you're going to need to give them a lot of light. I think this is just such a prime example of plants that stay small, as I have literally been growing this for at least 2 years, and I almost feel like it's like smaller than when I got it. There's just so much more going on at this point because it's just such a full clump. So I'm obsessed with the way it looks. It's like picture perfect, of course, minus the old plant dying back, but it's really got a lot of character. I think that this is a plant that's probably very underrated because it's not like a typical leafy foliage plant, but if you have a window that's really bright, I highly recommend giving them a go. They're very vibrant and they really do add a lot of color and life to your space. They're a little pokey around the edges. They're not gonna cut you, but you still wanna be a little mindful there. And this is a really excellent one right here. So this is a Pilea grandifolia. Now, I would say Pileas across the board are known for being plants that stay incredibly small. I just really have a place in my heart for this one. It's just such like a herbaceous looking plant. It definitely looks like something you would be growing in the kitchen and someone might be over and snip it off and start chopping it up for something that you're cooking, thinking that it's an edible plant, which It's non-toxic, but I don't think I would go around eating this plant. But I love this plant too because it has more of that like weedish vibe, like not like weed like marijuana, but like weed as in it's like a weed growing out the crack in the sidewalk, and I just ripped it out and planted it in a pot. And if you watch me here on YouTube, you know that's like my favorite type of plant. So this Pilea grandifolia hits that right on the money. It's also an incredibly easy plant to grow if it does require water, which I'm sometimes pretty forgetful with my 400 plus plants to water them. Sometimes I forget about one here or there. The leaves will just kind of wilt and it will look very dramatically like it's in need of water. I go ahead and water it, and by the next day it's perked up and good as new. This is one I've been growing in my home for probably about a year and a half at this point, and you can still see how small it stayed. I really don't see this plant getting much taller than this, and at that point it's probably gonna start branching out from here. And I could also just continuously cut it back and it will continue to branch as well, and I can just root the top. But like I said, I really don't see it maxing out any taller than this because I feel like it's been this tall for like 6 months now, so hasn't done much else than that, but it's such a beautiful house plant I have to talk about today. Another one that's extremely underrated. It is just so gorgeous. I love the shade of green that these leaves have. Okay, so let's talk about this one. This is a adorable Sansevieria. So this is Sansevieria trifasciata. I guess if you're a diehard, it's a Dracaena at this point, but we're gonna call it today Sansevieria trifasciata golden honeyeye. And I am realizing how covered in cat hair this plant is. It's right on the part of the couch that's like next to the windowsill where our cats like to lay, and they just get their fur all over our plants. So this is a very striking type of Sansevieria honeyeye, which is the bird's nest type of Sansevieria. So I would say any Sansevieria trifasciata honeyeye would fit into this category. I just want to talk about this one today because I think it's got such a striking appearance with its gold color. It reminds me more of those newer Sansevierias that are popping up on the market, like the Yellowstone, I think it's called. So if you're, you can Google it if you're not familiar, but really, really striking foliage. And I've been growing this one for a couple years now, probably about two, maybe two and a half, and it's barely done anything than put off like three or four leaves from the base of the crown, as well as put off this little puff back here, which is absolutely adorable. I love this little thing. There are so many types of Sansevieria honeyeye, so you can't really go wrong. If you're looking for a plain green, they got it. If you're looking for one that's nearly black, they got it. There was even one variety that we used to sell at the plant store that had like a white streak down the center that I absolutely loved. It was a little bit different than like Bantel Sensation, because normally I feel like all these honeyeyes like kind of mimic other types of Sansevieria trifasciatas, like the Zeylanica and the Laurentii, that makes any sense to you. But there are a couple really unique ones out there, so definitely keep your eyes peeled. It's such a great plant. It's gonna stay small for a really long time. Even at their largest, we would sell them in like 8-inch pots and they would still be like no taller than like 6 inches coming out of the pot. So always gonna stay really small, perfect for like the center of a table or the back corner of a kitchen counter or something where you just need something small that's gonna demand attention. And these demand a lot of attention, especially if you get one as striking as the golden honeyeye. This next plant, you're all gonna hate it. So this is a Tillandsia iananthe. So this is just a standard air plant, and these are going to stay small. This, specifically the iananthas, this is like the classic air plant. If you walk into a houseplant store and you want like the most inexpensive air plant that they're selling at the store, it's going to be a Tillandsia iananthe. And I really rarely see them any bigger than this. This is one that I've been growing in my home for probably about a year and a half. And do not knock air plants until you try them a couple of times. If you're like me, you probably brought home your first air plant or two and you treated them like the aliens that they seem like they are and just put them in any obscure space in your home expecting that, because they don't need soil and they don't need light either, and practically don't need any water. That is absolutely not true. These plants really do need light to thrive. So I grow this Tillandsia iananthe probably about 5 feet away from one of my south facing windows, and it's been doing great. And mind you, I actually have it like shoved into like a stick where it's kind of like wedged in there. So the way it grows is kind of flat. You can kind of notice the way it's kind of formed its shape over time, which I think is just kind of silly. It doesn't really matter. Just like the bromeliad or cryptanthus that I shared a little bit earlier, this plant grows in the same manner where eventually it's going to bloom and put all of its energy into that flower, which is much more show-stopping than the cryptanthus I shared. And then it's going to put all of its energy into making some pups from the base of the plant that will eventually form a new plant, and I can take them off or keep it as a clump, although it probably won't look so good with the main plant dying. And this death that I'm talking about with air plants and bromeliads and cryptanthus, it's not something to be afraid of. It's not like you're buying a plant that's dying. You're always going to get more plant out of it, as you saw with the cryptanthus, of course, as long as you are caring for the plant correctly. But I just don't want you to feel like you're buying an air plant and if it's blooming, it's just gonna die for you and that's that. You're buying future garbage. It's not the case, of course. As I said, gonna reiterate again that you have to care for them correctly. You cannot just put them in the back corner of a bookshelf and expect them to grow to their fullest potential. But do not knock air plants. Give them a try. Try them a couple times. Just make sure that you are putting them near a window. I like to spray mine with a spray bottle, like a really good spray, like once a week. Sometimes I'm a little lazy about it, but you should never go more than 2 weeks of not watering your air plants because they're just gonna crisp up and die. I know some people like to soak them. That's not really my method. I find that they rot pretty easily in that manner, but to each their own. Do whatever works for you. I'm not gonna tell you what not to do. I'm just gonna tell you what I do to help you out. Ooh, okay, so the next one is a doozy. So this is Peperomia argyria. This is the watermelon peperomia. And once again, I've been growing this plant in my home for at least 3 years at this point. And you can see how small it is. You can tell how long I've had this plant from the way it's kind of been creeping along the stem. So peperomias that grow in this manner, so that includes like Peperomia caperata, Peperomia verschefeltii, the Peperomia albivittatas like Rana Verde and Piccolo Banda, all of these are gonna grow in this manner where they have this central stem. It's very similar to like a Pilea peperomioides, which is also a great plant for this list, although I guess over time they can get rather big. A Peperomia argyria, this is, you know, as big as I've seen them get in the home. I've been noticing that you can purchase them in like the 6-inch pots. I think Costa Farms is doing them. And those things, they have to be like pumped with hormones to the max, because once again, a year or two ago, I found a very large pot of Peperomia argyria growing in a nursery. I brought it home and that thing did not look that good for that long. So, I mean, to each their own. The Costa Farms ones obviously are not very expensive at all, so go for it if you dare, but I've noticed it's a little bit better starting out small with my peperomias. If they've been pumped with those hormones and growing in that greenhouse space to their fullest potential, they are not going to perform that way in my home. I can tell you that for a fact. But this is such a cute one. I really love the way that it's been growing over time. It's a very easy plant. I have this one up on a shelf, so it kind of just tells me when its leaves start to get a little bit more lackluster, and I can do my taco test where I just squeeze the leaves in slightly and can kind of feel if the leaves have lost enough succulence that I need to go ahead and water it. But like I said, this one is a very good visual one, as these leaves are very striking and iridescent. It will kind of lose that sheen and luster that it has and just be a little bit more, what's the word I'm looking for? Dull. It'll be very dull. It'll tell you from a mile away that it needs water. The only thing about this plant is to make sure that you don't overwater it. That's a surefire way to kill any peperomia. This is one that I still actually have in the plastic pot. I find that that's kind of one of my secrets to growing these types of peperomias better, because if I were to repot it in here, I'm just telling you, over time it would deteriorate and maybe it would hang on and regrow into something good one day, but it would just kind of poop out on me. They really seem to like to stay set in their plastic pot and be on the dry side. So put it near a window, don't water it too much, leave it in its plastic nursery pot, and I think you're gonna have a nice tiny little watermelon peperomia for a couple years to come. I do have another peperomia I wanna talk about today. Admittedly, I have not been growing this one for more than like 4 months, so it's one I can't speak of experience as much as every other plant in this video, but I still think it's an excellent contender, and it's so very interesting. So this is Peperomia bamboo stalks. This is a little bit more of a lesser known collector peperomia, but it's still, by all means, as easy, if not easier, I would say, than the Peperomia argyria. So this is one that will require a little bit more sunlight, I would say, than the Peperomia argyria. I grow that one like a couple feet off of a window. Well, this is one that I like to grow right in a window or directly underneath a grow light. And I like to do that because these stems are, they're not thick. Like, honestly, I don't even think it's as thick as that main central stem of the Peperomia argyria, but they have this really nice ridging to them. That is where it gets its name, bamboo stalk. So you can see it's got that bamboo look, but they say if all the leaves were to fall off this plant and if you had like all the plant up here, it would look like it's bamboo stalk. So that's just explaining the name for you. Although I definitely would like to keep the leaves on this plant as long as possible. But in my experience, this Peperomia, if you are not giving it enough light, it's just gonna get really skinny and etiolated and just not look as good as you would like it to. So this is one, highly recommend putting it in a window. But even over the past like 4 months, I don't even know exactly how long I've had this plant, but around that time, it's really put off just this little tiny inch of growth, which is quite frankly more than most Peperomias put off. But what I know about this Peperomia is that it does grow in more of a verticular manner where it's just going to grow up. Is that even a word, verticular? Vertical? I don't even know at this point. It's gonna grow upright and it's not gonna grow like many other Peperomias, like, I don't know, Peperomia trinervis and Peperomia hope, that are gonna trail over time and they will become like a full plant if you let it. This is not going to be that. This is going to stay in this little 2-inch pot and it's probably gonna max out at like 6 to 8 inches before it starts putting all of its energy into producing some new pups. So a lot of Peperomias do also grow in this manner. So you could lump a bunch of other Peperomias in with this that grow in the same manner, just as the way that you could lump in like Peperomia caparata, like I mentioned with the argyria. So a bunch of varieties. This is just one example I'm showing you today, but any Peperomia that's gonna grow in this manner is going to stay very small. You just might need to keep it in a little bit more of a brighter light situation. And wow, I think I only have one more to talk about today, although I guess this is technically a duo because I would technically count both of these. So I'm just gonna glaze over this one right here. So this is a cactus, of course, it's an Acanthocereus tetragonus, and they call this a fairy castle cactus, but really, any cactus, like any serious cactus or mammillaria, they're all gonna stay very small and grow very slowly. You do need to make sure you have the right lighting exposure for them. I highly recommend growing all of your cacti in a south-facing window or a west-facing window, and I would give them a very harsh grow light if you do not have that kind of setting. So, like I said, just wanna glaze over cacti because this isn't necessarily the one I wanted to talk about today. I still think they're a great contender. So the one I really wanted to focus on is this right here. So this is Haworthia fasciata. So this is just your standard zebra Haworthia, I think they call it. And this is a plant. Actually, both of these I've been growing for maybe like 4 years, pushing 4.5 years at this point. These are two plants I've had for a very long time. And they have stayed incredibly small. This Haworthia in specific is one that I'm just like shocked at how meaty it's become over time. Like I said, I've had it for about 4 years, but it started at about half the size, which is pretty incredible that it's grown like as slowly as it has, but still looks so full and beautiful. So this is a fantastic plant. This is like the slowest growing plant that I'm going to be talking about today, just from the sheer length of time that it's been growing and its stature is so small. But these really do have that kind of fake appearance. I remember one of my friends in college had one of these and he literally thought it was fake, like it was a gift from like his grandparent or something. And he literally just thought it was a fake plant the entirety of the time until I like started digging around in the pot and noticed it was a live plant. So that actually kind of inspired me to get one myself. And it's been doing fantastic ever since. Actually, I believe at the time I purchased this with two, and it doesn't really matter, but I purchased this with two in the pot, and me and my current roommate, who was not my roommate at the time, just one of my best friends, we split it. But I think she forgot to water hers and she killed hers, but mine is still thriving to this day. So it really is such a beautiful houseplant. It looks fake. I don't blame my friend for thinking he had a fake plant. It's really so incredible how amazing this plant looks and how inexpensive it is. You're never gonna pay more than $5 for one of these things. So highly recommend it. It's perfect for lower light settings. While most succulents require brighter light, like a south or west facing window, as I had mentioned, this is perfect for lower light areas of your home. Of course, you can't go too dark. It probably will just wither up and die. But as long as you have it in the vicinity of a window, I think this is such an incredible plant. The slowest growing plant I'm talking about today. And honestly, the most beautiful, I'd be daring enough to say. So that's gonna do it for today's video. Small, tiny, mini, itty bitty plants that are going to stay small for practically ever. Of course, I'm sure some of these might have a turning point if you have them for like 10 years growing in a greenhouse, but honestly, in your home, this is pretty much as big as they're gonna get. So thank you guys so much for joining me today. If you don't already, follow me on Instagram at FullyFoliage, subscribe to my channel, and I will see you guys in my next video. Have a great day.